you for attending the last session that we have, and I'm quite sure we'll try and make it as realistic, as authentic as it can possibly happen. May I request everybody to be seated, please? Right. To start with, I'd like to invite Pradeep. He has a presentation that he would like to give, and we will have one more presentation. After that, we will have sort of a panel discussion on the different manufacturing and technology processes, improvements, efficiencies, where are the lacuna, and we will like to take it from there. Pradeep.
Good evening, good afternoon, everyone. I'll be making a small presentation, a very quick presentation on the what Redington is all about, and also what solar business at Redington, what we do. So I'll start with a brief introduction on Redington. So I'll start with what Redington is. Redington is a value-added distributor and a complete supply chain solution company, diversified across more than 20 countries globally. So Redington started off with distribution into IT products and services, and then diversified into other businesses. At Redington, our business is classified into distribution, then supply chain, and then services. Distribution, Redington does the distribution of all the products, and we have a dedicated supply chain company called ProConnect under Redington, which is a 100% subsidiary of Redington, which caters to all the supply chain needs of Redington. Also serves third-party customers. Then we have the third vertical, which is services. Because we distribute products, it's also important for us to give back it up with services. So we have a company called Ensure Support Services, which takes up the exclusive services for all the brands that Redington deals with, distributes. This is the network of Redington. We have more than 55 subsidiaries across the globe. More than 30,000 dealers or channel partners globally, and then present in more than 20 countries. In India, we have more than 90 warehouses across the country, from where we distribute products of various brands. Offices, more than 50 offices we have in India. So Redington is spread in India. We have one of the largest distribution networks. As solar industry today is supply chain, delivering the goods at competitive prices on time. This is what is required for solar industry today, and that is where Redington is playing a role to help the solar industry, particularly on the rooftop segment. Redington's solar focus is mostly on the rooftop, where we want to help the small, medium, and also the large scale EPC companies get their products delivered on time as quickly as possible. So this is our spread across India. We have more than 90 warehouses, as I said, more than 3,000 channel partners for solar business as well as our other businesses, more than 50 offices. So these are the some of the brands, partners, vendor partners whom we have been dealing with for many years. It's not just solar business, all the other businesses, which includes the IT and the non-IT businesses. So we have established very good relationships with these brands, and we have been working with them for so many years. In terms of revenue, today's solar industry, one of the important issues that any small entrepreneur or a small size, medium size EPC company has is, whether I buy a product, where do I go for a claim? If I go for a claim, whether do I have a partner who is financially strong enough to support the claim or give a warranty or service? So with respect to that, if you look at our financial credit rating, We are AA and AA plus rating. And in terms of our turnover in India, we do about $2.4 billion. And globally, we do about $6 billion. So $6+ billion is our global turnover. So EPC companies, solar EPC companies can confidently, you know, depend on a brand like Redington to make sure that, you know, their what they order or what they want is delivered. Some of the products we have, Redington solar business started in 2016, April. It's just 1.5 years into solar. And we have been tied up with many reputed brands for solar PV panels, solar on-grid inverters, then solar cables, off-grid inverters. All components that is required for a solar PV system, we have been able to tie up with multiple brands. So why Redington? Many advantages. Just-in-time delivery. So a system integrator need not have to invest his capital, wait for 15 days, 30 days for the product to be delivered. We help them the product readily available, so they can the project turnover will be very fast. So they don't have to block their working capital. Delivery to the last mile. Normally solar panels, what we do is EPC company is in one state, the project is in another state. So EPC company wants the modules to be delivered directly to the site. So we deliver it to the remotest locations, we have done it. And we make sure that also the insurance is covered, transit insurance is covered until the delivery point. So this is the one of the advantages that we give to our partners while working with Redington. So there are many other advantages, strong financial background. So any warranty claim, you know that Redington can, you can come back to Redington. These are the advantages IPC company has working with Redington. Some of the brands we have tied up with for solar panels, REC, Trina, then we have for the Indian brand Renusys, then we have Longi Solar, which is a monocrystalline manufacturer. Inverters, we have Growatt, Refusol, SunGrow, then we have for micro inverters, we have Enphase. Balance of systems, we have junction boxes, cables, we also have introduced few off-grid products, mounting structures we have introduced which will be available from next month. These are some of the supplies we have done in terms of ratings of the inverters or the plant capacities. New products that we have, we are launching off-grid all-in-one integrated street lights. Then we have something like solar off-grid power pack with inbuilt lithium battery. It's again a different ratings. Yeah, so this is our commitment to the solar business. Deliver the products just in time, competitive price, and backed up with service. So this is what we commit to the solar industry. Thank you.
Thanks, Pradeep. That was quick. Now I'll invite Ketan. Ketan from DNV. And Ketan, request you to keep it short and sweet.
Good evening. Everybody awake?
Yeah.
Good. So before the slides come up, just would like to see, like, you know, what kind of mix we have in the audience. So how many are from IPPs, owners, investors in the audience? This kind of category? IPPs, owners, investors? Okay, I see one hand there. How many from EPC? Okay, few. And how many from finance? Unfortunately, none. Because I believe finance is probably the one that takes the largest risk in a project, about 70 to 80% if we go by the typical debt scenarios. The finance companies give you funding for 70 to 80% of the capex. So, okay, interesting. Okay, so I'm going to talk about quality. Now, that was one of the key topics that, you know, was discussed in the last session as well, and I was really happy to hear the panelists talk about quality of the systems and projects. What we've been doing is, for the past few years, you know, testing a lot of modules. We have our own labs in the US, and we've designed our own test program to find out the reliability and the performance of modules, which is a combination of certain IEC standards as well as certain other standards which go beyond IEC requirements as well. We come up with what we call as a scorecard report. I'm not sure how many of you all have seen this. This is a freely available report, and we attempt to update this report every 1 or 2 years. And this is the third edition that we've come up so far in 2017. And I encourage and welcome everybody to kind of download this report from our website. It is freely available. This is a kind of a test protocol, just to give you a fair, idea of, what we do in this testing before we get into the results. So what we do is basically test the modules for conditions which are beyond IEC requirements. So we go two or three times, induce that much stress into the module when we actually test. So the protocols probably would remain the same. For example, when it comes to tests like thermal cycling, damp heat, humidity freeze, but we will do also do some extra tests like, dynamic mechanical loading, which is not part of the IEC standard 61215, for example. And we'd also do certain extra tests of PID, and we can also create PAN files based on measurement data to give you an independence when you're actually doing your simulation, so that you are very close to realistic estimates when you do your estimations for a project. And I'll directly jump into some of the findings that we have from the testing that we've been doing for the past 6 to 7 years. Okay, before that, I'll let you know that, in this 2017 report, these were some of the module manufacturers which performed at a significantly better or a higher level in the test that we've performed. And you see a lot of names in the report, which is basically global suppliers supplying to India as well as to markets outside of India as well. This is first finding of our test. This is basically result of thermal cycling of 600 or 800 cycles, I'm not able to see from here, but it is basically at least 3 or 4 times IEC requirement. And the modules that we test is all IEC certified modules. So, we select modules from the manufacturer commercial lines. They are not prototypes. They are actual modules which are manufactured for sale, not prototypes which are meant for certification requirements. So in that, what we see is, even though the modules are certified, there are about 5 to 6% of the modules which would not meet the IEC requirement if we were to test them again, picking up from the commercial production or from the warehouse and test them for the same IEC test for which they were tested. We would find that at least 5 to 6% do not meet the IEC requirement. This is one very important finding from our test report, because in the market, if you were to compare all the modules, every module is IEC certified. I mean, if it is not IEC certified, that module would not be actually, be available in the market for sale. That's a minimum requirement. But we see that minimum requirement is sometimes kind of, not met when you actually do an independent testing. This is another important finding. We heard the earlier panelists talk about bill of materials. Now, we know that for every module, every series or the same data sheet of the module that you have, there could be multiple bill of material combinations. And for obvious reasons of, maybe say supply chain or any other, reasons, the manufacturers can have different BOM combinations. Now, in our experience, we've seen that, different BOMs can perform differently. So the data sheet is the same. If it's, say, for example, a 300 watt module, and all the parameters which are listed on a data sheet, they would be exactly the same. But when you see, when you test different BOMs, you find different results. In this case, you see, there's a significant difference in the BOM. And when you actually induce more and more stress into the module, when you go 400, 600, 800 cycles, the gap in the performance is increasing. It gives an indication that into the lifetime of the plant, when it will reach towards the end of the plant, the degradation is likely to increase significantly for one BOM versus the other BOM. That's an important consideration that you need to have when you're actually finalizing or procuring modules for your projects. The other thing is the location. Now, as of now, we have maximum modules coming from China. Like, you know, most of the global suppliers are Chinese, and most of the factories are in China, but at the same time, there are some factories that are outside of China, maybe in Taiwan, Malaysia, some in Europe, some in US. What we've seen is there is no correlation of the location of the factory or where the models are manufactured versus the performance. So we've seen you could have good and bad performing modules from all the regions. So it's not like, you know, if the models come from Europe or US, they are very good. Or, you know, the models come from China, they are bad. Like, it's not that. There's a very good mix, and there's no correlation. So you could not make a decision based on the location of the factory from where the model is being supplied to. The other finding is the volume. Now, very often, we tend to rely on modules which are so-called tier one manufacturers. Now, this tier one classification is basically based on a lot of parameters which are all non-technical and which do not have anything to do with the performance or the reliability of the modules. They are probably the capacity of the manufacturer in terms of number of factories, the number of megawatt or gigawatts that they can produce in a year, number of lines that they have, what is the strength of the financial balance sheet, etc. These are all the parameters which go into classifying as tier one modules. But in our experience, again, you have a very good mix of, you know, even probably smaller players producing good modules and larger players producing not so good modules as well. So again, your tier one classification or the size of the manufacturer is not a good proxy for making purchase decisions. There's no correlation in the performance of the module versus the size. And the last is, again, you know, the attention to quality. Now, what we mean by is, in our program, we've seen a lot of manufacturers participate once, and at the same time, there are many manufacturers who are participating time and again, which means every time, whenever they're coming up with a newer and newer module, some tweaks that they do in their technology, in the process that they manufacture, they want to test it for their performance and reliability. So the manufacturers who are kind of, you know, coming back to us and testing with us again and again, we see very good performance in their modules, rather than, you know, some one-off module manufacturers who come to us for, you know, one-time testing and things like that. So it's a very clear indication that, you know, manufacturers who are very quality conscious would come to these kind of voluntary programs for testing and then demonstrate the quality of their modules by these independent testing. So in short, this is basically a kind of a recommended practice, if you will, that, you know, what process you could follow for procurement decisions. So one is, you could request the manufacturers to produce the testing results of the modules of the bill of materials that they would want to supply to your projects. You review those test results and then make a decision, purchase decision. Once the purchase decision is made, what you could also do is, you know, take some sample modules from the manufactured batch and then test it independently for some serial defects or thing like that. By this, you are reasonably sure of what you've got for what you've paid for, actually. So these are some of the recommendations that, you know, we have from an independent test laboratory perspective for your manufacturers. So if there are four or five vendors that a specific investor is actually looking at, he has reviewed their test reports, which means the module manufacturers have perform these tests through an independent test laboratory like us, and only then a bank or a EPC developer is going to procure modules from that supplier. So in conclusion, you know, the good news is that a lot of module manufacturers that we've tested with perform very well, but the tier one status, all these things are not a good proxy. And as I said, the bad news is, like, you know, you can't pick good performing modules just based on the tier one classification or the size of their manufacturing or the strength of the financial balance sheet of the manufacturer. The other thing is, you know, you insist on third-party accelerated testing reports because they are a very good indicator of the quality and the performance of the module. Ensure that whatever BOM has been tested, whatever test reports that you have reviewed, you are buying the same bill of material combinations. Because if the test is done on some other bill of material and what you're being supplied is something different, then again, there's no correlation for the performance of the module. So you should ensure that, you know, you buy the same BOM of the report which you have actually reviewed and approved. And even when you do all these rigorous procedures before making a purchase decision, and as I said, what you could do is still, you know, pick few samples from the module, from the manufactured batch, and then independently test for any kind of defects or, you know, quality issues that you may find. And there is a 5 to 6% that we have found that the modules probably will not meet the IEC requirements. So with that, I end my presentation. I'll be available to take questions after that. That's all.
Yeah, thanks, Ketan. So what I will do is just to make sure that everybody is awake. That's a good presentation. Make sure everybody is awake. I'll have two people who have not asked questions before ask questions if they want to, two people. And just to add to what Ketan was saying about the bomb, I was just reading a report in PV Tech, I think it was September 2017, where they had done an analysis and they found that even all the big guys, you can barely trace about 50 to 60% of their bomb. So if you're talking about 10 gigawatt capacity, traceability is about 60% and lower. So that means 4.5 gigawatt is going to people who they don't know where their bomb is coming from, what quality they're giving. So these things are very, very important. So I'm going to open the floor for two questions and then we're going to have our panel round and then we're going to do questions again. So any two people who have not asked questions, who want to ask some questions? Yeah, you've not asked before? So okay, you're eligible.